Good morning to the second day of the conference, Education Shock. We had a very, very good start with yesterday's sessions. And I'm very much looking forward to today's three panels and seven talks overall, and the discussions entailed and sued by them. Yesterday, on this first day, we've been discussing questions of experimental pedagogies and their spatial manifestations in regard to, I mean, particularly with regard to West German school buildings, but also referring to and attending to the architecture and the designs of playgrounds and in various places, not only in Germany. And one of the questions, or I mean, many questions came out of this, or many interesting, I mean, aspects have been raised. But I think one of the things I took with me is this kind of strange way in which these architectures and these pedagogies have been torn between notions of openness, child-centeredness, between economical demands and political agendas, and how these architectures have also always been these reflections of the changing conditions of and conjunctures of liberalism and capitalism, or liberalist capitalism, and these reflections were in their were extremely shifting and quickly developing and coming in and out of the picture since the developments on the technological level, on the developments within the educational discourse, the developments of the kind of economical and politically economical environments in which these space and placemaking endeavors took place were changing rapidly in these 2 decades, and so there was this kind of ongoing process of revision and rebuilding, also rebuilding already built buildings. So this was a continuous process of adaptation to the changing conditions. And I think these temporal aspects and these aspects of how the parameters under which these educational spatial politics were took place will also be a concern, or will also be an interest of today's sessions. The second part of the day, the second panel yesterday, was then attended to a southern perspective, or south perspective, a south-south perspective also, focusing on two cases of West African anti-colonial education, militant education, and the educational facilities and designs being put into place in a post-liberation, in a post-independence situation, these two examples, Guinea-Bissau and Ghana and Nigeria, and Nigeria in the 1960s and 70s, were also telling about how the experimentalism of education and of educational production of space, or space, or the production of educational spaces, is unevenly. Is unevenly distributed and can take place, or can be extremely manifest, in situations where you wouldn't expect a certain kind of experimentalism taking place. For example, in the forests, in the forests in of in the mangrove forests of, on the coast of on the in the coastal regions of Guinea-Bissau. So there was so this was a very very interesting, I mean, addition or a necessary addition to these rather Western-centered examples, case studies that we've been discussed in the morning, yesterday's morning, and today we are kind of trying to push this kind of transnational dimension of the conference and of the project as a whole a little bit further with a first panel that takes several examples of socialist architecture and education architecture as starting points to reflect on the way in which the kind of East European Soviet GDR architectures and their standardizations and their typologies might differ or not differ that much from the standardizations and the modularizations and the way and the ways to create economically savvy or economically viable spaces in the West. So this is now where we're kind of shifting the gaze towards Eastern Europe, East Germany, but also again in the final presentation, again towards the way in which Eastern Europe, the Soviet Union, has been in a constant dialogue, in a constant negotiation with the Global South. I would like to introduce the three speakers of this first panel, and before I invite them to the stage, the first speaker today will be Oliver Zucro. Oliver Zucro is an art historian who is currently assistant professor at the Technical University in Vienna, and I came across his work via a colleague of ours, Thomas Flield, who recommended his really brilliant dissertation, which was turned into a book on called or titled Arbeit, Wohnen, Computer zur Utopie in der bildenden Kunst und Architektur der DDR in den 1960er Jahren. Dwelling, computer. It's of course an allusion to Heidegger's famous essay on the utopia of visual arts and architecture in the GDR in the 1960s. And there's a particular building he's going to focus on today, and which was also the focus of this. This is the focus of this book. The second speaker this morning will be Dina Dorothea Falbe. Dina Dorothea Falbe is an architect and a writer, and she has moved her practice towards architectural history in the past years, and is currently working on a PhD at the University of Groningen on East German educational architecture. And the third speaker will be Elke Bayer, whom you know from yesterday, Elke moderated the second panel in the afternoon. Elke is an urban researcher and architectural scholar, and currently working at the Institute for Architecture at the Technical University in Berlin. She received her PhD from the ETH, from the Technical University in Zurich, and was part earlier in the two. In the 2000s, she was part of the Shrinking Cities team, a very important project focusing on the ways cities are vanishing almost in the process of the post 1989 reorganization of the geopolitical space. Without further ado, I would like to welcome Oliver onto the stage. Please give him a warm welcome. Thank you.